Today I will talk about some of the mechanisms used in container and how it relates to Kubernetes. First, my name is Alban. I am CTO at Kinfolk. We are a team of developers in Berlin. And we focus on Kubernetes on one side, on low-level Linux development on the other side. And you can come at our booth where we can talk about Flatcar Linux, a Linux distribution we started. So the plan today is to talk about system call and go through different layers in the Linux kernel to talk about different container mechanisms. So I will talk about the open system call, where we open a file with a write mode and go through different layers, like a seccomp to filter system calls, to the implementation of the open system call and do the file lookup. We'll talk about permissions and capabilities, SLinux, and in the end, about overlay.fs. So let's start about with seccomp. Even before the kernel knows that it's an open system call, all syscall goes through the seccomp mechanism and has the opportunity to filter the seccomp. So how it works, seccomp has actually two modes. The first mode is the strict mode, where it actually only accepts read, write, and exit. So that's very limited what it can do. And any other syscall will be denied, and the process will be killed. So this is more for sandbox. That's not really useful in the context of Kubernetes. For Kubernetes, we prefer the other mode, which is filter mode, where we can actually install a custom BPF program and decide exactly what system call to accept and which one to deny. And from that, we can do different actions, allow the system call, or kill the process, or return an error, depending on the system call. This is the same thing with the diagram. So when the application does the system call, seccomp BPF will execute the BPF program and return one of the possible actions. If it is to allow, then it will continue to the execution of the system call in the kernel, or otherwise it will not go there and kill the program or return an error. BPF program, how many of you know what is BPF? Almost everybody. So you probably know that BPF is a bytecode here. It's a list of instructions and that will return an action. It's a BPF program is executed in the kernel, triggered by some event. In this case, for every system call, seccomp will execute the BPF program attached to the process. The program will receive as input a struct seccomp data with some information about the system call, and the program will have to decide what action to take. It's quite limited in what it can do. There can be no loop in the program. The program cannot access to the kernel memory or to the memory of processes, and there is no not much more than that. So there are limitations, and here is the seccomp data, the structure that the BPF program will receive for every system call. You can see there is the instruction, the system call number, so to distinguish between open, mkdir, etc., and the arguments. So if I take this example with the open system call, the first parameter is a string. It's a path, a file name. So in C, it's actually a pointer to a string, and in BPF, we can only access see what the pointer it is, but we cannot dereference it, so we cannot know which file it is from that. So we cannot do everything, but we can know that it's an open system call, and we can some of the parameters, we can understand them without the reference, like the flags. So the other limitation is once a BPF program is installed on the process, we cannot change it. We talk about classic BPF here and not extended BPF, so we don't have access to extended features like BPF maps to store context, or we don't have other BPF helper functions. We cannot do loops, we cannot do complicated things like strcmp, string compare, and we cannot dereference pointer. But still, it's useful. We can still decide which system call to accept or not. And in Docker, Docker does exactly that. Docker has a default seccomp filter, where by default, everything will return an error. But there is a whitelist of system calls which are allowed, the safe system call for running in a container. Some system calls are denied in Docker. For example, the system call add key. This system call is not namespaced, so it's not considered safe to run in a container. But that can be changed if you want to write your own filter list to define which syscall to accept or not. You can pass a seccomp profile on the Docker command line. And the same thing applies to Kubernetes. So I mentioned here it's a work in progress in Kubernetes that's actually working. But the issue is not closed because at the moment it's defined as an annotation in a pod YAML file. And that's a feature that exists for a long time, I think, since Kubernetes 1.3 or 1.4. But on the issue they discuss about making it a proper property. So let's say the open system call was accepted by the seccomp filter, as it is the default with Kubernetes and Docker. And then the kernel can execute the code for the open system call, and it will have to find which file to open. So we will talk about file lookup. File lookup can be done differently on different processes. It can be done differently because processes can be ch-rooted. If it lives in a different ch-root, the root of the file system is different. Typically, in different containers, we'll have different roots. And when following the directories, different containers can have different mounts, different volumes. So things are done differently here. So in Kubernetes, we can mount volumes. In this example, I take directory on the host, slash data, and it will mount it inside the container at this path, slash test PD. That's an example from the Kubernetes documentation. And the same thing represented differently. On the left, you have the tree directory on the host, on the right in the container. So you have the rootfs of the container, which is mapped to slash in the container, and the volume that we wanted to mount at this space is available here. With containers, you have something called mount propagations. What it is if the container decides to mount a new mount below this mount, we can decide whether we want to propagate it to the host or not, and in both directions. By default, a new mount or a change of mount in the container will not be propagated on the host because, in general, we don't want a container to be able to affect the host. But that can be configured differently. In Kubernetes, I think it's since 1.10, there is this option, mount propagation, where you can define the mount propagation. And here, if you say bidirectional, it means the pod will be able to mount something in the container, and that will be propagated on the host. That can be useful for implementing, for example, flex volumes in Kubernetes, where we actually want a pod to be able to configure volumes on the host. Kubernetes is not the only software that uses this feature of the Linux kernel. For example, systemd has a very similar thing. That's a systemd unit where you define a service and you have this parameter mount flag where you define how you want the mount propagation to happen. And even though that's not Kubernetes, that's still useful to understand because in some configuration, here I have the kubelet running on the host, and then the kubelet will talk to Docker to create a container. And if the Docker was created as a systemd service with the mount flag private, it means there will not be any mount propagation between the host and the Docker namespace. So in this configuration, even though in Kubernetes you use mount propagation bidirectional, for example, that will not be propagated until the host. So typically, the Docker service is not started like that, but it used to be the case in some distributions, so that was a bug that is fixed now. So now the open system call passes seccomp, and we find which file to open. And now the implementation of the open system call will have to decide whether the permissions and capabilities allow to open the file. First, the permissions. It's a classic Linux or Unix permissions, where whether you have access, read, write, execute access for the user, the group, or others. There is also these capabilities. Typically, the user root, even if a file doesn't belong to root and other doesn't have access to it, root typically still have access to other files on the system. Typically, because root has the cap-dac override capabilities. So on Docker and Kubernetes, we can define in the container which capability a container has access to. So it looks like that. In Docker, we can use cap-add or cap-drop to add or remove from the default set of capabilities. And in Kubernetes, it's the same thing with those properties in a pod YAML file. Capability add and drop. Capabilities don't exist. They exist, but they are related to the user namespace. So on Linux, you can have capabilities related to one user namespace, but not to other user namespace. So user namespace form a trees. And that's important for some other system call. I will take the example of the mount system call. When you do a mount system call, you need to have capsysadmin, but you need to have capsysadmin in relation to the mount namespace where you are located in, and that mount namespace must belong to the user namespace where your process is in. So in the left configuration, a process created a user namespace on a mount namespace. In this case, you are allowed to mount things in your mount namespace. But in the situation on the right, if you create a user namespace, but the mount namespace still belongs to a different user namespace, then you don't have the capabilities on the initial user namespace, but in the current user namespace, so you are still not allowed to mount something, even though you are you have capsysadmin. In Kubernetes, we don't have user namespace yet, but this is something which is discussed in those issues on pull requests. This is discussed including very recently, so at some point we will have that. And even if it's not relevant for Kubernetes yet, it's still interesting to know about that because you can run applications inside a pod on Kubernetes, and application can use unprivileged user namespace to do further containing or sandboxing. An example of that is the tool IMG, image. It's a tool that doesn't require any privilege to create a new Docker image, for example. So now we have our open system call that pass seccomp. We find the file to open. The permissions on the capabilities were OK. We could open it. But we still could be restricted by SLinux. So how many of you use SLinux? Maybe 20%, something like that. So SLinux is a Linux security module. And Linux security modules are a series of hooks in the Linux kernel. And for example, this one called security file open, that's something that will be called for during the open system call. And then security file open will give the control to one of the Linux security modules, in this case SLinux, to decide whether it's allowed or not to open that file. And each Linux security module can take decision differently. In the case of SLinux, it works with labeling. So SLinux will label all the files on the file system could be labeled, and the process as well. And the kernel will enforce policies. A label looks like that. You have different categories, and they are used for different purposes. In the case of containers, we have the type container T. I think that's the default on Fedora, that process in containers are assigned to that label. And the, there are kind of two parts to do two different roles. The part on the left in blue, it's for type enforcement. It means that the process in the container will have some restriction on what files on the host they can access to. I think by default on Fedora, you can access to /user/bin, but the logs in varlog could be restricted. That's something you can change the configuration or your policies. On the part on the right, typically containers are assigned a random categories. And the goal is that every container will have different categories and they will restrict how they can communicate together. So a shared volume between the two could be restricted. So the two containers can not talk together. And in Kubernetes, that's something we can change. In the security context, we can define some SL Linux options. So we can change all of the labeling system for the containers. That only makes sense in when you together with configuration, the policies you have on your Linux distributions. Different Linux distributions can have different policies, and you can change that. Some have SL Linux enabled, some not. And this is a kind of global pictures. When a user has on the left in blue a pod YAML file with some capabilities, some SL Linux option on seccomp. When we do a kubectl apply, it goes to Kubernetes. First, we check role-based access if it's OK for that. But not all the pods might be accepted. There is now in Kubernetes 1.10, I think, a pod security policy. That's an admission controller that will decide to access accept this pod or not. And this is based on the pod security policies that the cluster administrator can define. So you can say, for example, I will use this seccomp, you can use this seccomp profile, but not this other one, and things like that. For SL Linux, you can do the same as well, but you also need to change the SL Linux policies on the host, on each node where you can run the containers, so that your policies have labeling system that match what you define in the pod security policy. Finally, I will talk about overlay file system. So our open system call passed seccomp. We find the file to open. We pass the permission checks and capability checks. We pass SL Linux, and now we can finally open the file. If the file is on the overlay file system, which is could be typically the case on containers, then I will first explain what overlay is. But how many of you knows or use overlay? Okay, almost everybody, a good part. So that's we use overlay for when we have a big image used by several containers. We don't want to copy this image for every container. That would be a waste of space and time. And so we use overlay to have the different layers. The first layer will build the image file system. And on top of that, we, where will be stored the difference whenever we write on the container. And in the container, we will only have the merge view for those two layers. So when we want to write on inside the container on overlay.fs, first we open a file with a write option. It will first do a copy up, where we copy the file from the base layer into the upper overlay layer, so that after, when we write to that file, we can write to the copy and not change the image itself. And when reading on the file system, if it is an unmodified file, the read will happen on the base layer, or if it was modified, we will read the change. So when we run a lot of containers with a lot of overlay file system, we have a lot of upper layer that represent the diff, what has been changed in the container. And with Kubernetes, we could, every time a pod die or is terminated, at some point, there will be a garbage collection where the Kubernetes will clean up the old containers. And there is some heuristic to decide which one to clean up, but by default, I think it clean every minute, it looks at the list of dead containers and will consider the edge, how old it is, and the space on the disk, etc., to remove them after a while. So that's what we have talked about today, seccomp, file lookups, permissions, capability, SLinux, and overlayFS. Do you have any questions? Yes? I will try purpose.
When you were describing overlay, you describe how Kubernetes cleans up a space when you delete the base image. But what happens with how does it compact though the diffs? For example, if you create and delete a file, you put two diffs on top. So when how does that happen?
Right. I will go back to the slide with this one, for example. When we delete a file, actually in this upper layer, we will write a whiteout file with a syntax .wh whiteout with the name of the file. And that's understood as meaning that this file is not there anymore. So even though it is still in the base layer because that's read-only, in the merge view, we will not see this file because that's a mark to say it's removed. Other questions?
Maybe it's out of scope of your talk. If so, please tell. Yesterday, Google introduced gVisor, and there's also this tooling called Sysdig. Maybe you can explain a little bit about how they work.
About the Google tool, I've not looked into it, so I cannot reply. Maybe someone else can reply in the room. On Sysdig, I cannot give exact answer, but I think it uses a different mechanism with a trace point on kprovs, maybe. Maybe someone in the room is from Sysdig. Other questions or remarks?
Since Syscomp is so limited, can you give us some example of what it does? What kind of checks it does?
You can define a list of system calls that you accept or not. I can show you. If you go to that URL, there is the default seccomp profile, and it defines a list of all the system calls that are accepted. So that can restrict already some syscall that we don't want to accept. And I think for some of them, we can consider the arguments. For example, for the unshare system calls, we could decide to allow unshare for some flags, but not others. There was some attempt in the kernel to improve that and use eBPF for extended BPF, but there are complexities there that make it not easy to do that.
Uh,
One of the difficulties is time object, time of use, because a seccomp happens even before the kernel can execute the system call. So if in the if the file name that you try to open change between the time you execute seccomp and the time you execute the system call, that could be inconsistent. So there are the kind of issues that are difficult to resolve.
More questions?
Okay, thank you for coming.